wear a bra or not to wear a bra is hardly the most essential question of this movement. That's not where the action is, you see. The action is to change society, to restructure society. That I am free to wear a bra, not to wear a bra, is my business.
Okay. Why don't you shack up and say, look, you wash the dishes today, I'll wash them tomorrow.
Well, that's what I've been saying.
Well, Stim, you shack up, go ahead.
But you seem to think this is repulsive.
I think it's repulsive, that
women should get married this way and be under their husband's tutelage, so they do have to do what he says.
You know,
but the women tell you what's natural. They're trying to tell you all the time.
You certainly aren't speaking for them, because the women I've talked to don't want to be liberated in the fashion that the women's liberation are talking about.
But there is something different about tonight. There is something special about tonight. What is different? What is special? I, Barbara Jordan, am a keynote speaker.
It's interesting because at that period of time in the 70s, there was this vibe, you know, women could do any, we could do anything. You could have a career, you could succeed in whatever you wanted to do. You know, it was like no holds barred. Everything was opening up for women.
I think it was about the 1970s. That women started asserting themselves in all fields, and therefore things opened up in jazz.
We were driving back from the Wichita Jazz Festival, and we're lamenting the fact that Kansas City had nothing comparable. Kansas City being the cradle of jazz, we thought that was kind of sad. And so Carol said, I have a radical idea. Why don't we put on a women's jazz festival in Kansas City? That came out of the fact that women very rarely ever get featured at jazz festivals anywhere in the world. We called Marion McPartland. She was very excited about it. She said, I don't think it's ever been done. Let me know what I can do to help. I would love to be a part of it.
We co-founded the Women's Jazz Festival in 1977, way long time ago.
Way back when.
That's right. And it was the first time it had ever happened.
Leonard Feather was our master of ceremonies, God rest his soul. Leonard Feather had done more for women in jazz. He produced them. He traveled with them. He booked them. He
wrote about them, publicized them. So we came up with the idea just of the concert.
Just of the concert.
We were going to do this great concert that featured women. And then so it would be like a 4 or 5 hour concert on a Sunday.
That would be our gift to the
world.
That
was it. Boy, we were excited about that. That would be great.
We started hearing from people all over the world. We're coming in. You're going to have more than just a concert, aren't you? And we went, oh.
It turned into a 3-day festival. And then it ended up having a 5-day festival for the last 3 years.
I heard this band for the first time in Hollywood. I wrote them up for the Los Angeles Times, and I said, this is the best all-female orchestra possibly that I've ever heard, Maiden Voyage.
In 1980, when Maiden Voyage was playing the Kansas City Women's Jazz Festival, so they had a tribute to the International Sweethearts of Rhythm, and they invited all of the still-living members of that band to come. And they asked us to play for that tribute. And it was just an amazing experience to meet them and to play with them. We had a jam session.
I mean, if you just think about who was on that first concert, Marion McPartland with her trio, Dynamite.
Mary Lou Williams.
And completing the group is a wonderful musician who gave up the American music scene to take up a post as a teacher at the Jamaica School of Music in the West Indies.
The one and only Miss Melba Liston.
We can say that we were the ones that got Melba Liston out of retirement. Her playing on that concert would melt steel.
Oh,
it was,
she was
so incredible.
And she played for several years after that.
And she went back to New York and revived her career.
If I'm not involved with anything else in my life, the two things that were so exciting were bringing Melba Liston out of retirement and reuniting the original International Sweethearts of Rhythm. It really brought some attention to some women that I don't think have ever gotten their just desserts.
Mm-hmm.
remember the women who were really visible to me at that time. It was like Barla Bley and Toshiko. Joanne Brackeen. Lori Frank. These were the women who I saw who were out there, who were playing and doing what I wanted to do. I was a woman in a man's world. I was a woman playing a brass instrument. I was a woman who was leading an ensemble. In other words, I wasn't going the track of being a side person. On some level, of course, I knew it was hard for women. But, you know, at the time, I think I was walking around like with blinders on. I was all of, I don't know, 21 or 22, and, you know, I thought I could conquer the world.
Well, although a lot of people may know me as a R&B singer, which I totally consider myself not to be, that's not really where my roots are. My roots are in jazz.
Well, when I first had a chance to hear Patrice, I noticed the daring and the courage she had to reach out beyond the barrier. It was unusual for any musician of that age. And so the fact that she was a female was even more unusual because there were so few instrumentalists.
I think I was just really, really fortunate. By the time I got serious about the music and really wanted to involve myself in playing jazz, I didn't have to deal with anything other than playing the music. And I think when your purpose and your goal is in front of you and you're doing something that you feel strongly about and something that you love, all the stuff you might have to encounter is just stuff you have to encounter. But the women's movement and the fact that by the time I was out there, there was this consciousness about possibilities and that in all facets of life and all facets of business, you were beginning to see that the idea about what a woman could or couldn't do be broken down. So it really knocks me out when the women come and really come with it. I met Terry Lynn when she was about 9 or 10 years old. Then I heard her play and I was like, oh my goodness. Because such a command and a maturity. And I said, oh, this is great.
My father plays saxophone and my grandfather was a drummer. People like Cannonball Adderley and Nat Adderley. Papa Joe Jones and Clark Terry and all kinds of people would come to our house for dinner. And so it was very much in me, even before I knew that that's what I was going to do. I got my union card when I was 10. My first gig out of town was with Clark Terry when I was 10. And I had really nothing but support. From the jazz community, the men in the jazz community, so it was a very different experience for me.
Terry Lynn Carrington is not a drummer that you could say, oh, she's a great drummer for a girl. No, she's at that upper level.
But when I came up, I was hard-pressed to see any women playing drums.
It was almost like a given that you wouldn't hire a female drummer. Because a drummer has to have that testosterone in the sound.
Because there were a few women that played drums before, but I don't think there were really any people that did the diverse things that I did as far as playing with legends like Dizzy Gillespie and then Stan Getz and then contemporary legends like Wayne Shorter and Herbie Hancock. Then having the experience of playing with Herbie, it was really pretty amazing to me because when I grew up, I felt like if I ever played with these guys, you know, I really made it.
Because she was a pioneer. Female drummers now don't have to sound just like men. They can have a feminine aspect to the way they play.
you know, I didn't really have role models in that regard, but, you know, I felt so embraced that I didn't see it as a problem.
I moved to New York in 1985 to pursue a career to be a jazz star and play jazz drums. All I wanted to do was just be one of the guys. That was my fantasy. So just, you know, just fit in and blend in, and hopefully people would just pay attention to my drumming. I go to a jam session in New York City, of which I went to many, 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 every single night. And I would sign up on the list and get such, you know, a rough time. Take your shirt off. I'll let you sit in. Can you handle this tempo, honey? And it would make me seethe in fury. Like inside, I would feel like a volcano about to explode. It was so infuriating and stupid because I did everything that I could possibly think to do to be a good player, you know, and just because of my gender, to hear these dumb comments was so aggravating and sort of, you know, fueled me to go forward. I never thought about all-girl projects or all-women projects, and it wasn't really something I was ever interested in, because traditionally and historically, everything that I knew about at the time that women were involved in was not as excellent musically as the other things I heard from our male counterparts.
I am so enthusiastic about the state of female jazz musicians. You can go from the tradition of big band and its growth with diva to amazing instrumentalists, amazing players, Ingrid Jensen, Terry Lynn Carrington, to composer pianists like Jerry Allen. I love Jerry Allen.
I think jazz is a real clear metaphor for what is best about humanity. The way we improvise, the way we share, the way we trust, and those kinds of things that happen in the best moments of the music.
Those moments on stage where you play music and it just, you connect with the other musicians, you connect with the audience, and you're just being yourself, you're just playing. And everything, those moments that everything just gets calm.
I don't know of any men that are doing what Maria Schneider's doing. She really has created her own sound, and she's a person that's carving out the future of larger group music in jazz.
I never ever thought of myself as being a woman doing what I'm doing. When I put out my first record, Evanescence, I still remember a journalist came over and he said, "What's it like to be a woman composer?" And I said, what's it like to be a male journalist?
In retrospect to all the things I've done to get to where I am in the music, very little of it has had anything to do with being a woman. The only thing that I can honestly say has gotten me from point A to point B has been being in love with music, all kinds of music, and wanting to play music with people that want to play music with me.
I did show up to a gig and a sub for elderly gentlemen, and like one guy didn't put his dentures in. And so anyway, they were telling me that they wouldn't pay me. Actually, they said they were going to cut my pay. And they said, this one guy said,
well, so-and-so didn't tell me they were sending a girl. And I thought, I still want my money. Well, so we gonna cut you $5. And you know, with somebody with her finger, I know we gonna cut you $5. I thought, okay, I just wanted to laugh.
One of the things that I think is the biggest change is the women themselves. We don't walk into the situation concerned about somebody else's baggage about whether we can or we can't. Our focus is in being good at what we do, and more it's becoming just a mindset on women's part that's not a hurdle that we have to deal with anymore.
I only realized it, you know, a few years ago, that all my idols have been men. No teacher ever talked to me about Mary Lou Williams or Marian McPartland.
I didn't know who the Sweethearts of Rhythm were. I didn't know who Vired was. I didn't know any of that.
The first pianist that I saw, jazz pianist, was Terry Pollard. And she was playing with Terry Gibbs at the time. And I'll just never forget the intensity of seeing her on stage and how fierce she was. And it was like, wow, there's a place for me in this music, you know, from seeing her.
I've seen some stunning young women coming up. And I have to admit to you, one of the things I love about them is that there isn't even the inkling that there's anything that they can't do. There's just complete confidence and comfort with themselves about who they are as women and what they're going to do in the world.
Yeah, I think we're going to see the music grow immensely. And instead of trying to approach it, women coming to a man's world, that maybe that's the difference. We kind of all realize, like, this is not a man's game. If you really look at the facts, it's our game, you know. You know, we're creators. We are creators.
I think it was a Women in Jazz Festival, and I was really excited because Terry Lynn Carrington was playing drums. Ingrid Jensen, who plays in my band, Joanne Burkeen was playing piano. And then the band, all the horns, were all men. So we were playing the concert, and it was just killing. I mean, Ingrid was playing her butt off, and Terry Lynn, I mean, it was amazing. And I was standing to the side watching Ingrid solo and watching the rhythm section play. All the guys who were the horn players were just looking on. And they were all just like leaning forward and totally grooving on how heavy the music was. And it got me kind of choked up because I was thinking, wow, that's not something you see very often.
Quincy Jones told me something when I was in high school. And he came up to me, he says, what do you want to do? And I said, oh, well, sir, I want to write and I want to play. And he just looked right in my face. You know, you're going to have to be very, very good. You want to be good anyway. But if you're the girl in the band, you have to be.
I hope we get to the day soon where that's not something people think about and categorize.
A lot of men had a very specific and very limited view of what women did and their roles in society, their roles in the family. And it's important to give them a little leeway in saying that they had never seen or understood how women could do what some of these women musicians were trying to do. They were limited in their ability to understand it. The women that came before us were so diligent and so brave to continue pressing and continue to be an example of what the life as a female jazz musician could be and could look like.
I would say to the Clora Bryants, the Dorothy Donegans, Mary Lou, Marian McPartland, I want to say thank you. I knew about it because some of them told me about it. My mom told me about it. And hopefully every note that I play represents, hey, I know that you had to maybe, you know, go to upstairs in someone's room to collect your paycheck. I'm grateful I've not had to do that.
Thank you.